Good morning, Cornerstone.
It looks a little thin today. People are going to show up. People will show up. People always show up. All right.
Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. Yeah, welcome. I'm super excited this morning to just be here and to worship the Lord. Let's all stand for a call to worship this morning. This is, you know, the third time, you know, third or fourth time I'm leading, and I think you guys will see a trend. You know, our lives are busy, and unfortunately, the Lord many times kind of gets put in the background. Things take precedent over him. Things like, for me, my kids and work and school and tiredness, fatigue, and a lot of times, unfortunately, I forget to make him the priority of my life. And so what I wanted to do and what I do every Sunday is let's just come before the Lord and let's quiet our hearts and let's get ready, because we come to church to fellowship, and we come to church to hear the word of God, but most importantly, we come to church to glorify him through the singing and through the studying of the scripture. And so why don't we just take a moment, let's quiet our hearts and let's prepare our hearts to come before the Lord, and then I'm going to open us up in just a call to worship. Lord, we come and we worship you, God, for you are worthy of all of our praise. It says in Psalm 100, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth, and serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is good. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep in his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. I'm going to read verse 4 one more time, because I just, that is our prayer, and that's my encouragement to you this morning. Cornerstone, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you and hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. It's in your presence all our fears are washed away, washed away. You make us new. washed away.
Come out of the way of my life.
is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I'll stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God and helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands on victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell,
is because of the power of your blood that we can stand. God, that we are called sons and daughters. And so God, as we continue to worship you this morning, as we continue to walk with you, God, may we be reminded by the power of the blood. For the one who was, for the one who is, and for the one who is to come. The most beautiful thing about that is that you never change and you are constant and consistent, and that your love endures forever. We thank you and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
All right. Thank you, music team, for leading us in worship. My name's Eric. I'd like to welcome everyone here to Cornerstone Christian Fellowship today. I have a few announcements for you. The first is, did you know there's only 4.5 months till Christmas? What? Yeah, I know. That's crazy, huh? But one of the great things we do here at Cornerstone is around Christmas time, we send a missions team to Oaxaca, Mexico. And so Believe it or not, that's going to be coming up before we know it. So if you're interested, and it's a great family mission, so if you have kids maybe that you're thinking about, it'd be great to set an example of what it means to be the hands and feet of Christ in another country, to minister and love on people in a different culture. This is a great opportunity. And so there is an informational meeting that's actually today, 12:30 here, so you don't even have to go anywhere. So after you get lunch wagon, you can go find out more about the Oaxaca mission that Cornerstone sponsors. And so it's a great opportunity. Lots of people have gone. And so that's something that you're interested in either going back to or maybe checking out for the first time. Would encourage you to go to that informational meeting again today after service. And the next announcement is regarding young families. So if you have a student, a child that's fifth grade or younger, then this is for you. So this is going to be the first meeting, and it's going to be kickoff lunch, and that's going to be next week at the Ministry Center. So you can RSVP in the app, and hopefully all of the young families can get together and have a great time fellowship and connecting with each other and passing your kids off on someone else for a little while. And so I would encourage you all to go to that, for you young families. If you are a little at the next stage and your kids are sixth grade or older, so that includes high school, maybe college, maybe they've gone to college and come back to live with you, regardless, so the next two groups, so the midlife Christ in Us and the legacy groups. So we are having an estate planning session coming up soon, and so whether you need to do your own estate planning or possibly in these groups helping parents with their estate planning or managing some of those responsibilities, and you're not quite sure what to do, then we would encourage you to come out to this session. You can hopefully sign up soon in the app, but reserve the date. It's going to be on September the 10th, and so would encourage people to come out. That's a great practical thing to do, and then also rub shoulders with those two care circles. And I believe that is the last announcement. Yes. And so at this time, I'm going to invite everyone to pray with me as we release the kids. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for today. We thank you that you love all of us, regardless of which care circle we're in. We know that you love the kids. We ask that during their rock time, that you would help them to know that they are loved by you. No matter who they are, what their gifts and talents are, you love them all equally and unconditionally. So we ask that you would help the teachers and the helpers to be able to share your love with them today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So this time, I'd like to dismiss all the kids to rock, and everyone else, please give each other a warm Cornerstone welcome.
All right, as we're coming back in, let's go ahead and take a seat. Come on forward. We got extra seats up front as well. But we're going to go ahead and continue our worship service right now. Today is actually an opportunity for us to have our compassion ministry segment. Amongst the ministry, the many ministries that we have here at Cornerstone, the compassion ministry is one of those which we share about every couple months up here on Sundays, just to give an idea of some of the opportunities that you have as, and that we have as a church to engage with the community, engage with the world. And one of the partner organizations that we've had a really good relationship over many, many years with is Jubilee Reach. And even just proximity-wise, you guys might recognize the Jubilee Reach Center, which is just down the block here, as well as we have a couple folks in our own in our church here that work for Jubilee, Pastor Warren and Jennifer Lee and Don Harada. And today, we're just really blessed. We're actually very fortunate to have the Director of Community Care, Ken Carpenter. He's going to be with us to share about this annual event that many of you guys are familiar with, and maybe some of you guys are not, called Jubilee Service Day. So I'm going to go ahead and call up Ken. Why don't you guys go ahead and give him a warm welcome, please. How you doing, brother?
Good morning. I'm well. Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, thanks for being here, Ken. Well, as I said, we've been doing Jubilee Service Day for many years, you guys obviously since the inception, but we have a lot of new folks at Cornerstone that maybe aren't quite as familiar with Jubilee Reach, or even more specifically, what Jubilee Service Day is. So if you could just give us a little bit of a background on what takes place and its inception, its history, and so forth, that would be really helpful.
Terrific, and I'll be as quick as I can. There's a lot to say. Quickly about Jubilee Reach, it started in 2006, started by a church, but has been run independently ever since. Our center is adjacent to this school, and a lot of great things happen out of there, including community care, which I operate. A lot of people know our thrift store over by Fred Meyer, which is really kind of a secret mission outpost for us. About half of our employees work inside the Bellevue Public Schools, helping every kid feel like they belong. And then we organize many community events, which helps this community connect. Jubilee Service Day actually started the year before Jubilee Reach began. The service day started in 2005, Jubilee Reach in 2006. And Jubilee Service Day is an annual event in August, late August, on a Saturday. Started in 2005 with one church going to the public schools and saying, we want to help. And so about 800 people went over to Stevenson Elementary and cleaned it up, made it nicer, helped the teachers. And that was supposed to be it, but it was very popular, both within the school and the school district. So the next year, four schools were in, and four churches were in, and it just grew from there. And Cornerstone has been involved since nearly the beginning. The point of the service day is for the community, and I'll just say the capital C church, the church community, to come into the public schools and help the teachers and staff feel loved. And think about that, the Church of Bellevue coming to the public schools, invited, welcomed, and now nearly 20 years later, the relationship is very, very strong. At our peak in 2019, before the pandemic, there were about 50 churches participating, about 26 schools receiving volunteers. The physical and actual work that we do is helping the teachers prepare for the new year. So going into classrooms, organizing, decorating, cleaning, anything you might expect. You can sit in a little kindergarten chair and cut. But the goal is so the teachers can get all of this work done by volunteers so they can really prepare for the new school year. Beyond that, we also have a partnership with the City of Bellevue where we take volunteer groups into the community and help homeowners. And what started in 2010 on the Jubilee Service Day is now a season from about March through October where volunteer groups go into the community and help people with yards, painting, fences, things like this. They apply for help, and then volunteer groups go out. We've done 58 projects so far this year. We'll probably finish around 85 before the rain comes. So that's really what Jubilee Service Day is about.
There's so much history there, right, as you said, coming up on 20 years almost. And with your experience and your longevity at Jubilee Reach and just seeing God work over the years, you got to have a few stories or just accounts of different families or individuals or teachers or whoever that have been blessed through Jubilee Service Day. So it'd be great if you could share some of those with us.
Yeah, the stories are really what catch people, and I honestly could sit here for an hour. And if you really wanted to, I could make you cry. There are some really touching stories. For the schools, there are definitely things that pop up every year. The first that I would tell you is that for a new teacher, having such help is truly unbelievable. We have had teachers cry because they just got hired the day before their service day and school starts next Tuesday. What am I going to do? And here comes an army of volunteers and everything gets done. We've had teachers profess, this is incredible. I have never seen this. And these are teachers who have been working for decades. We've had the school district defend the church when there have been people or groups who speak up and say, why is the church coming into the public school? Shouldn't there be separation? And the district steps up and defends and says, no, they're great. They've been here for years. Leave them alone. You want to do your own service day? We'll see you in another time. But the church is welcome inside the public schools. Your church is in a public school. The school side of the service day truly brings love. And if you ever ask a teacher, do you feel loved through this day? They will say yes. On the home side, I'll share a couple quick stories. And the homes part, you get more intimate because you're in somebody's actual house. A couple quick stories. Last year, we served a lady up behind Eastgate Elementary. Some of you may live up there. She actually had applied for assistance during the pandemic, and we didn't do a lot of houses for a couple years. So when I went back to her house June of last year, I honestly thought she had died because the house was so overgrown. I couldn't get to the front door. If I could show you a picture, you would just think nobody lives there. And the only way I got in was talking to a neighbor, and she was there. She's in her 80s. And we built a relationship, and that summer her sister died in Belgium, and we were there with her. We walked through that with her. We hugged her. We held her. And then we actually did clean her yard. It took two groups to do it. And when we were finished, and she was sitting outside holding a teddy bear that somebody had given her, and I said to her, Annie, do you feel loved? And she speaks with a British accent, so I'll give you my best. Oh, sir, I most certainly do. Do you know, before this day, I wanted to stay inside. I didn't want to go out, but now I want to go outside. I didn't want to see anybody before, but now I want to see people. Before, I wanted to stay in the dark, but now I want to go into the light. And, sir, before, I wanted to die, but now I want to live. And I don't want to be too dramatic about it, but her words were genuine, and this changed the trajectory of her life as we're in her mid-80s now. Lastly, I want to share one last story. This is actually from a person who emailed me this Saturday. The Jubilee Service crew, including Jen and Don and Warren, we did a service project on Friday, which we do every year, and this woman emailed me on Saturday morning. I'll read you just a little bit about it. Dear Ken and everyone, I can finally put together words. Jubilee gave such an enormous gift. I was lost for words, struggling to let it all in. Walking around my yard today, I realized how much had happened yesterday. Impossibly, my house and yard were transformed. Jubilee staff sacrificed valuable time and boundless energy to show me God's abiding love. No amount of money could buy what you did. Except for you, the mess would remain. My stress and discouragement would remain. Nobody else would come even take this job, let alone pour the love and care into it that you did. But God did the impossible. He sent you. It was a joy meeting your team. I was deeply healed, admitting my need, overcoming my shame, accepting your help, and feeling honored for my early work at Jubilee myself. God is at work in you and me and the Jubilee community. The point of the house programs is so people feel loved, period. We do this through service, and I will just tell you, it works. It works.
That's awesome. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. It's really powerful. You know, one of the goals of our compassion ministry at Cornerstone is to be able to create opportunities for our church to collectively just go out and be the hands and feet of Jesus to the Bellevue community, to the world. So obviously, there's different paths that we could take coming up for Jubilee Service Day. What are some specific ways that we as a Cornerstone Church, whether individuals or through our CGs or our community groups, that we could participate in this coming Jubilee Service Day?
Yeah, so the Jubilee Service Day is 2 weeks from yesterday, 8 o'clock until noon. It's about 23 schools participating. You can register to participate. I know it's on the Cornerstone app. It's on our website. You certainly can serve here at Lake Hills. I'll be honest, this school is very popular. It fills up very fast with volunteers. But I also know most of you probably don't live in this proximity. You live all over the place. So if you have a school near your house, it's likely it's participating. Serve there. If you go on our website, you can see the percentages of what's full and what's not. It's great for all ages. The elderly can come. We have low impact jobs available where you're sitting down. Kids are welcome of all ages. You can bring your little ones. We don't have an age restriction at all. So it's wonderful for families. So please come. It's a wonderful day. There's plenty of fellowship, and people walk away just feeling very, very pleased, very happy, like you're participating in a bigger project. I always describe the service day as kind of like building the wall of Jerusalem. You know, there's schools all over the city. You just are one little spot in it, but collectively we're building this wall of love around this community. If you're interested in helping with the house, we do a few on the service day. Most of them are done on different days. Next week we have 3, the week after we have 5. If you have a small group, a family, a large group, your company, reach out. We can set up a service day for you. And lastly, this is a little unique, if you're interested in sewing, if you have the skill of sewing, we actually have a component of the service day that involves fabric and sewing and serging. We actually do that year-round to support the schools. So if you have that talent, reach out as well. There's many ways to get involved. The biggest thing is just come. Just show up.
That's awesome. Yeah, so like Ken said, you can sign up on the Cornerstone app. If you guys have any questions, go ahead and email me, and I can also direct you to Ken as well. Thank you, brother, so much for coming today. I really appreciate you. Let's give him a hand. Thank you. I'll call up Pastor Stephen.
Hello, hello. Oh, okay. All right. I didn't know that I was a pastor, but that's news to me. Thank you. So, no, I have not yet taken that position here, but I do have the privilege of sharing today's message, and we are continuing this series of challenging passages that challenge us. And so these are scriptures and passages in the Bible that are a little bit hard to read, that the first impression when you read them, you might think something, and at a minimum, it's going to be challenging. And so I encourage you to take an opportunity to listen to some of the previous messages, because each message focuses on one of these passages. And honestly, there's so much that God wants to show of his heart that may not be apparent when you just glossingly read over that particular message or that particular verse. But today we are continuing this, and so we're going to be focusing on Luke chapter 9. And we're going to be reading out of verses 57 through the end of the chapter. So if you could stand with me as we read the word of God. Verse 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But the man replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. You may sit. I'm just going to pray for us really quick. Lord Jesus, I thank you. I thank you that you are the author of this Bible. I thank you that you are the Word. And I thank you that we are here today to hear your word, to hear your truth. And I pray that our hearts would be fertile, that our hearts would be in a place to hear your hearts for us, for those of you, that those of us that know you and those of us that still don't know you. I pray that our hearts would be willing and open to hear what you have for us. So God, I just pray that your presence is here, so that your message would be heard, that your intention would be heard, that your son's love would be made apparent and obvious to every single one of us. I thank you that you are the Lord that saved us, that spared no expense for us. So I pray that we would just know you more. So God, I thank you. We love you. In the name of Jesus, amen. So when I was growing up, snowboarding was actually way more popular than skiing. I hear these days it's actually reversed, that all the young people actually want to ski. So that's a change for me. Because when I was, I grew up skiing initially, but once I got into middle school, my brother actually took up snowboarding. And I don't remember whether it was him telling me I should go snowboard or if it was me being like, oh, I want to be cool and I want to go snowboard. But I ended up on the slopes of Snoqualmie with my brother, his friend, and they were both snowboarding, myself, who was snowboarding for the very first time, and my dad, who knew how to ski. He knew nothing about snowboarding. And then my brother, you know, started to teach me how to snowboard. This is what he said. He said, to go left, you lean back. To go right, you lean forward. And then him and his friend left me. That was it. And I was like, oh, okay. So I was like, oh, I guess it must not be that hard, right? If he only gave me like 10 seconds of instruction and then just left me on my own with my dad who doesn't know anything about snowboarding. So I was like, all right, I'm going to go jump right straight in. And as you expect, I was amazing. I was a natural. I just coasted down. No. As you expect, I fell, and then I fell, and then I fell, and then I fell, then I fell, then I fell, then I fell. Then I literally fell down for 3 to 4 straight hours. It was to the point where, you know, my dad, he was just probably just helplessly seeing me fall down. He couldn't tell me anything to do. He just had to be there and just watch. And so I remember after that experience, I was sore for the entire week, for like 7 days straight, okay? So I was in middle school. I wasn't 40, because right now I get sore over like anything, right? I was in middle school. You're like made of rubber at that point. I was literally sore for 7 straight days. That experience taught me that maybe I shouldn't snowboard. It was a couple years later, I actually ended up snowboarding. I became okay. But that's besides the point. Sometimes in life, when we experience new things or something draws us in and we want to do it and we want to become involved in it, we dive head first without truly knowing what entails and what it means to do that thing. In fact, oftentimes we don't count the cost that comes with that. And here in this scripture, in Luke chapter 9, these men who have been with Jesus, watching him do his ministry, watching him do amazing things, have perhaps mostly seen just miracles. In fact, up to this point in the book of Luke, Jesus has cleansed the lepers. He's healed paralytics. He's taught in synagogues amazing teachers of the law. He's cast out spirits. He's raised the dead. He's calmed storms so that entire lakes are smooth and calm. He's fed 5,000 men and their entire families just with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Can you imagine just seeing all these things in real life? Wouldn't you be astounded? Wouldn't you want to follow this person who is doing all these things? Let alone that he is saying that he is the Messiah of Israel. And the thought was that the Messiah of Israel was going to deliver the people of Israel from their enemies. He was going to free them from the rule of the Romans. He was going to establish himself as a king, as a politician, to reestablish the kingdom of Israel. And that would go on for the rest of time. This Messiah, this Jesus, who Jesus was saying, I am the Messiah, he was going to bring the people of Israel to glory. If I was there, I would say, sign me up. I want to ride on this ride. And that's what these three men were thinking. But they didn't think about the cost to follow Jesus. So what is that cost that Jesus is trying to communicate to us here? Verse 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. This man is being honest. He's like, I will follow wherever you go, Jesus. And Jesus' response isn't like, all right, let's do it. His response is, I don't know if you really understand what you're asking for. You see, even the animals of this earth, even the birds of the air, have some place that they can call home, some place that they can find security, safety, comfort. But Jesus is saying that while I'm here on earth, I will not have any of those things. In fact, I can guarantee you one thing. You will have adversity. You will experience rejection. If you follow me, if you follow my ways, if you share my story, you will experience hardship. You will have no stability. You will not have comfort. At least you can't count on it. I guarantee you adversity. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus goes back to Nazareth. Nazareth is where he was born. Nazareth is where people knew him as the son of Joseph and the son of Mary. They had seen him grow up from a child and become an adult. And this is his first time coming since he started his ministry. And so he went into the synagogue to people that he knew, and he shared his message that he was the Messiah. And initially, they were astounded. They were in wonder. They're like, who is this man? Is this Joseph's boy? And yet he is saying these things now. And they were like, wow, the Messiah. But then as he continued to teach, as he continued to speak, he started to reveal the hearts of the people of Nazareth. And what initially occurred and was started out as wonder started to turn into anger. It started to turn into rage. And ultimately what happened is that these same people who knew him, who grew up with him, took Jesus out of that synagogue to the top of a hill with the intention of throwing him off a cliff so that he would die. They were there to kill Jesus. Jesus escaped. Going through the crowd. But this example in his own life shows that even his home, what we think of as home, was no home. They weren't there to support him. They didn't even give him the grace to be like, oh, wait a minute, maybe he's just having an off day. They tried to kill him. You see, the cost of following Christ, the cost of following his word, is adversity. That is guaranteed. You will experience adversity if you follow his word. We are in a world where we are going to be counterculture to what is accepted, to what is expressed. That is a guarantee. And if we don't understand that, then we cannot follow him. This last month and a half, I've had an opportunity to spend some time with people who have truly decided to follow Jesus. And along the way, they said, I'm willing to give up my comfort and my security. In fact, I don't want it, but I'm willing to go into adversity. Pastor Duane, I had some time to spend with him, and I know that 3 or 4 weeks ago, he shared about his vision to plant a church in Chattanooga, Tennessee. But along that way to get there, to get to this place where he felt like, hey, this is what God wants me to do. You know, he left Cornerstone a year ago, knowing that God was asking him to go, but he didn't know where to go. Do you realize he was just bouncing around from, like, you know, out of the country to in the country? And not only that, it wasn't like he was by himself. He's married to his wife, Jess, and they had children. And so they're going around from place to place with no security, no home, no idea what he was going to do. He was applying for different sort of positions to be a pastor. At some point, he thought he was going to come out of ministry. He was applying for regular jobs. He had no idea. And then finally, God said and led him and convicted him and just led him to know that he's going to plant a church. Planting a church is scary on its own. There's a lot of things that come with it. But to imagine being in a place where you don't know what you're supposed to do, and God is simply saying, just trust me and follow me. But it's not just you, it's your entire family. Like, you've uprooted your family, your children, from their friends, from their community, from their schools. And yet, he went and did that. I also got to spend some time with some friends of myself and Helen's. Michelle and Drew Brown. In fact, Michelle has known them for 15 years, and some of you had the opportunity to meet them too. They're missionaries currently in Costa Rica. But before that, they were missionaries in Mozambique. And actually, that was the calling that they felt that their whole family was called to. They expected for themselves to be in Mozambique for the rest of their lives. See, they have 4 young children also. And so when they were in Mozambique, what they encountered was a lot of hardships. You know, that's a third world country. There's not a lot that is there that we have here. And when she was pregnant, when Michelle was pregnant with her 4th child, during her first trimester, she started to have just consistent vaginal bleeding. Vaginal bleeding that the doctors there had no idea why it was happening. And it was to the point that her life was threatened. The bleeding would not stop. And it wasn't just her life. It was her baby's life, too. They were airlifted out of Mozambique to South Africa. And she was there. And the doctors still didn't know why she was bleeding. She was there for a greater level of medical care. But she had no idea. Eventually, she had to come out of South Africa and come back here to the U.S. to try to find medical care, to also to find a reason for the bleeding. And they still couldn't find a reason for the bleeding. Thank God, eventually, her son was born. He's healthy. And then they went back to Mozambique. And their intention, again, was to stay there for the rest of their lives. But along the way, there was more health issues, and eventually, I think it was one of her children also had to be airlifted out of Mozambique, again medically, because there's no medical care that could provide for them what they needed. Eventually, God called them out, and they ended up in Costa Rica, where currently they are serving and teaching pastors and also equipping missionaries to go out from Costa Rica. But you understand that they gave up a lot of what we consider here as home, because they were following Jesus. They did it at the potential risk of their own lives and their children's lives, too. Their daughter, Alethea, she's 10 years old. And during a conversation, she sort of mentioned this thing about what she says when people ask her where home is. And she's 10 years old, and this is what she said. She said, "I was born in Ohio. I grew up in Mozambique. But I live in Costa Rica." See, there's this implicit idea that her parents have taught her that there isn't a single place that she can call home, but more so because there isn't a home here on earth. You see, the Bible tells us that we are citizens of heaven, that home, The place where we should find security and comfort and stability isn't any address that we have here, isn't any home and shelter that we have here. It's in heaven. We're not supposed to be here for longevity, for eternity. We're supposed to be in heaven. And when our eyes are set forward on a home that is not of this earth, then we can start to follow Jesus, because Jesus was homeless while he's here on earth. He had no home. But his home is in heaven, and our home is with him in heaven too. Where is your home? Where is your home? Verse 59. He said to another man, "Follow me." But the man replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." So there's something that first pops out from this verse. Jesus actually says to the man, "Follow me." He poses him the question, "Follow me." And what the man says is, "God, Jesus, first let me bury my father." That doesn't sound like an unreasonable request. In the Jewish culture, a proper burial for one's family is incredibly important. In fact, it takes precedence above anything else that can happen in a day, because they expect that body to be buried that first day. It can't wait. It needs to be done. That's the cultural expectation. That's what people have grown up with. And it makes sense. You're mourning for someone that you love. You want to respect their memory that day. But Jesus says, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." That seems like a harsh thing to say when someone just died. But there's something that's actually important to know about this statement when this man says, "Let me go and bury my father." Yes, it's possible his father may have died that day. But many scholars and many theologians think that he may be actually referencing a second burial. Because in first and second century Jewish practices, when someone died that first day, they would take them and put them into a tomb. And then they would have 7 days of intense mourning, and then 30 days of slightly less intense mourning. And then after that, they would wait for the flesh on the body to decompose, leaving the bones. That potentially could take up to 11 months. And then they would take those bones, and then they would put them into a bone box called an ossuary. And then this would be considered the second burial. So in actuality, scholars think this man might be referencing the second burial. So he wasn't asking God, he might not be. He's not saying, "God, can you just wait a couple hours, then I'll go with you." In fact, he's asking, "God, can you wait a couple weeks, or can you maybe wait 11 months until I can bury my father all the way through?" And then some scholars think that he actually wasn't referencing that his father had actually died, but that he's actually saying, "I'm waiting for my father to die so then I can bury him." So then that's even a longer time period, because then it's like, well, am I waiting for a year, 2 years, 3 years before this actually happens? So that's, I think, what's being said here is that Jesus is referencing more the idea of where his heart is, where his priorities are. And when we don't totally know, and whether this man is asking Jesus to wait for a day, or he's asking him to wait for 3 years, ultimately the question is about priority. Jesus is saying, "My priority in this situation, no matter what, even though how difficult your situation is that the gospel would continue to be presented to people who are alive." Because he's not saying, "Let the physical dead bury the physical dead," or, you know, that's not what he's saying. He's actually referencing the spiritual dead. He's saying that the people who do not believe in him or have heard about him, have not chosen to follow him, who are spiritually dead, well, let them worry about the cares of this world. Let them worry about the traditions of this world. Let them put that as a priority before trying to pursue and know more about Jesus. But for those of us who want to reach the spiritually dead, for those of us who want to give life-giving news, let us first go spread the word of life and truth so that people can respond to that and become spiritually alive. It's not that he's saying that honoring someone's death is something that's bad. What he's saying is that God's word is that much more important. He's implying a sense of urgency. He's implying the sense that I don't want you to ask me to wait. I don't want you to keep asking, God, just wait. Before I do what you ask me to do, just wait for me, Jesus. No, he wants us to follow him when he asks us. A couple months ago, I had a patient that he was coming in for a follow-up from a hospitalization. He had some substance issues that led to him being admitted into the ICU on a respirator. He was near death. Thankfully, he was able to be extubated. Thankfully, he was able to recover. And by the time he saw me, he had little to no disability from this traumatic event that he experienced. But what he was telling me was, and what he reflected to me, was an extreme sense of regret about what he had done and what had led him up to that point. He also had such a regret because he knew he had a wife and he had two small children. And he knew that he had to change and make continual changes in his life so that he could care for them. 3 to 4 weeks later, I got a report from the hospital, and this same man had been readmitted. He had been found to be in a stupor. He had found to have neurological abnormalities. He eventually came to be in a coma. And he ended up getting this diagnosis called PRES. It's posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. And it's something that is a constellation of neurological symptoms where people might have neurological abnormalities like visual hallucinations, seizures, stupor, or coma. And then that is matched up with an MRI or head imaging that shows a certain type of radiological finding. But the thing about this particular diagnosis is that it's reversible. In fact, the majority of people can come back when they're treated, and they can come back, and the majority of them actually come back neurologically intact. And so when I saw this report and I saw he had the diagnosis of PRES, I've had several patients that have actually come back and been entirely normal after their experience after having this diagnosis. And so in my mind, I was like, oh, gosh, that's horrible. But you know what? You know, he might be okay. He might be okay. And then I just didn't really follow up on that. A couple weeks later, I had a well child visit, and there was a young boy with his mother. And after I had gone through the visit, the mom just told me to hold on a second. And so I, instead of leaving, I was like, okay, I sat back down. And then she says, do you remember my husband? He's a patient of yours. And then in my head, I was like, oh, who's this? Because like honestly, I have such a bad memory. I can't remember everyone that I see. But then I was like, oh, wait, okay, yeah, I do remember who your husband is. And she's like, did you know he was in the hospital? And I was like, yes, I saw a hospital report. I saw what happened to him. And she's like, I just had to put him on hospice. And I was like, hospice? I was like, what happened? What happened to him? And she said that the neurologist had tried to treat his PRES. They had given him treatment, and they had given him additional treatments, and they kept trying whatever they could. But whatever happened, nothing was working. He never came out of his coma. He never started to respond back to their prompts. And eventually, they told her that there is no other treatment for him. And because she knew he did not want to be in the state that he was in, She made the hard decision to put him on hospice. And then what she said next just really stuck with me. She said when he first left the hospital, the first time, that she was so happy that he came back. She was so happy that he was normal, that he could still talk, that he could still interact with his children. He was so happy. She was so happy he was there. There was a chance, there was an opportunity to build something else from this horrible situation. It was an opportunity for him to be there for his family, for his wife. But then all of a sudden that was taken away. It was gone. Never to come back ever again. It was gone. And as she wept in this room, the one thing in my head that just kept returning and just repeating itself was, time is short. Time is short. We don't have time. When Jesus is asking us to follow him, when he's asking us, this man, to follow him, and we keep saying, wait for me, Jesus, just wait. Let me take care of this first. Let me bury my father. Let me finish my job. Let me do this. Let me focus on all these different things. Just wait, God. I don't have time. There is no time, I'm telling you. Time is short. We have no guarantee we will be here for the next second, let alone the people that love us, that know us. And for us to hold on to the truth of Jesus, that is spiritual life, and to not give it to people who are spiritually dead. That is the urgency in which Jesus puts into this passage. That is the urgency in which God wants us to have. There is no time. Are you asking God to wait? Are you asking God to wait? Verse 61. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord. But first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. This guy wants to follow Jesus. And yet he's saying, first, let me just say goodbye to my family. Which seems like a very reasonable request. But then Jesus replies, no one who wants to put the hand on the plow, meaning that when you have a plow in a field, you need both hands in order to direct it in the way it's supposed to go. Because you want to have a single furrow so that you can plant your crop properly. But if you only have one hand on the plow and you're constantly looking back at the things around you, you're constantly distracted, then there's no way to keep it straight, and you can't do the things that God has called you to do. But that seems like a really harsh response to a simple request about saying goodbye to your family. Is it because God thinks your family, your loved ones, are a distraction? Because that might be how you read this passage. Maybe you have to give up everything that's dear to you. Is that what Jesus is saying here? Because that's a little different than how Jesus speaks about family in the Bible. And that's different how the rest of the Bible talks about how we should care for our families. In Matthew 15, Jesus says this, you know, follow the commandments, honor your father and mother. In Mark 10, he talks about a man and wife leaving their parents to become one. And he says, what therefore God has joined, let no man separate. And then finally, in John 19, when Jesus is on the cross, he's been crucified, he's dying, and he sees his mother Mary, and he sees John, his disciple, there. And what he says to them is this. He says to Mary, "Dear woman, your son." And he says to John, "Here is your mother." And then John takes Mary to his home. The reason why he is saying that is because he cares for his mother. Even though he is accomplishing this task in which he came to earth for, which was to die on the cross for our sins, he is still thinking about his mother, and he wants to care for her. He's letting her know that even though I am gone, here is another son that is going to take care of you. If his idea of family was that they were a distraction, he would have told John, who is his disciple, to not do that, to not specifically take one of his 12 disciples and portion out that part of his resources to his mother. He wouldn't have done that. But instead, he is showing that he cares about family, that he loves family, that he wants us to care for our families. So how do we reconcile these two different thoughts? This thought that God wants us to put our families behind us, but yet at the same time, Jesus wants us to love and care for our families. How do we reconcile these two competing thoughts? When I got married and I was saying my vows to my wonderful wife, Helen, I said one thing. I said, "I will love God first so that I can love you better." Later, I had some friends talk to me and ask me about that, and basically said that didn't sit right with them. They're like, why did you say that? You know, this marriage is supposed to be about you and Helen and about your love for her. Why are you saying you love God more? And what I told them was this, is that I know the love I have for my wife is finite. I can only love my wife so much. I know that God loves her more than I love her. And I know that if I love God more, and in a sense, if I am trusting my wife and her love to God, then by that truth, I will love her more because I am putting my faith in God. I can love my wife more because I love God more. Because that's what God tends to do. When we put our eyes on the source of love and of life, then in every single way, the rest of our life is impacted so that we can love the others around us even more. You see, in this situation, even though God is asking us to put our families behind us, he's asking us to let go of our families. He's asking us to let go of ownership of our families. He's letting us to let go of letting our families be the lordship over our lives because he wants to be the Lord over our lives. In actuality, what he's saying is, give me your families. Give me your wife. Give me your children. Entrust them to me. So that they're not what is the driving force behind why you're doing things, but entrust them to me and know that I will care for them, I will love them, and that they will be cared for more than whatever way that you can think of. You know, I've been married for 9 years now. And honestly, I need God even more to love my wife more. I need God in order to be able to really try to give her the love that she deserves. And we have sort of this running joke. In my vows, I also said that I'll be the first to repent. I'll be the first to apologize. That's not true. But that's still my desire. And I'm hoping that God will continue to change my heart. But I know that with my own discipline and my own work, I will not be able to accomplish that. I need to trust my wife to God. I need to let go of my wife and focus on God. And knowing that God will care for my family, will care for my wife. But But you know, sometimes when we trust God with our family, it doesn't look the way that we think it will. In fact, oftentimes it goes against sort of maybe even common sense. Oftentimes, if we trust our families and our loved ones to God, it may seem that we actually go into adversity. In Genesis chapter 22, verse 22, God says this to Abraham. Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about. So Abraham, who loves God and is following God, is now told by God to sacrifice his son. Pastor Joe talked about this a couple weeks ago, so I'm not going to go super in-depth with it. But ultimately, Abraham took his son, Isaac, with a bunch of sticks on a donkey up to a hill. He tied his son up on the altar, and he's going to get ready to sacrifice him. He's going to get ready to kill him. Now, he did this because he trusted God, because God asked him, but also because in Hebrews 11, it says this, Abraham reasoned that even if his son Isaac died, that Jesus would raise Isaac from the dead. His trust in God was so much that he believed him even beyond the obvious understanding or the obvious result of killing his son. And God, because of his faith, sent an angel to stop Abraham and said, because you did not withhold your son, I know that you fear the Lord. And he provided a ram that was caught in the thicket to be the sacrifice that day. And so it wasn't that his son was sacrificed, but it was this ram that was given by God to be the sacrifice. You see, Abraham fully let go of his child, trusting that God would care for him. But you know what's even more interesting about this point? Is that God asked Abraham to sacrifice his child. But you know the biggest difference between Abraham and us? Is that Abraham didn't have Jesus. You see, God gave his only son, Jesus Christ, who was sinless in every single way, to take upon every single sin that we've ever had, are currently struggling with, and will ever have for eternity. And he took all of that upon himself, and God sacrificed his own child. And this time, he did not stop. He let Jesus go to the cross to be tortured, to die for us, so that through his sacrifice, our sin could be forgiven, so that we could have a relationship with God, so that we could have a new life, so that when Jesus rose from the dead and conquered death, that we, knowing him and following him, would also conquer death. You see, because God made the sacrifice of his own son, we no longer have to sacrifice our most loved ones. When God says, put these things behind you, he is not saying, sacrifice your family for ministry. Sacrifice your family for what I'm asking you to do. We no longer have to sacrifice. The sacrifice has been paid. He's asking us to trust our families and know that he will care for them and know that he loves them more than we love them. He wants us to entrust our families to him. He wants us to trust him. Do you trust God? Do you trust in God? You know, the cost of following Jesus, it's not an easy one. Going through this passage, you know, God will ask us sometimes to give up things I mean, there's obvious things that we can give up, things that we know we shouldn't do, the certain things in our life that God says we shouldn't do in his Bible that we need to give up. These are not good things because these are not life-giving things. So, and sometimes it even cognitively makes sense that, oh, okay, we can give up our comfort. We can give up these things and these material goods. But then when God is asking us to give up our family, that's a hard thing to do. But know that God is not asking this because he just wants us to be in pain and wants us to sacrifice. He wants us to join him on a journey in which we will experience his lordship and so spread his news so that his good news can make people spiritually alive. And also know that in the process that our families will thrive and know that our relationships will thrive. And so truly, God's heart is for us. And know that when we follow him, the cost is worth it. If I could have the music team come up. You know, we're also going to have an opportunity to receive prayer. So, you know, I would, as a challenge for this week, I would like all of us just to think about these questions that I have up there. Where is your home? Are you asking God to wait? And do you trust in God? Because I think these are key questions that all of us have to wrestle with as we try to understand where we are in following Jesus. And I know some of us don't believe in Jesus. Maybe we're not there yet. But what I would encourage you is that, yes, the gift of Jesus is so true. And yet sometimes the cost might be daunting. But I'm telling you the truth, it's worth it. And while when we talk about cost, this gift of salvation is not free. Because there is a cost, but it is available to everyone. And everyone has the capability to put their trust in God. So if that's stirring something in your heart, if we have our prayer intercessors on the side, if you want to receive prayer, please receive prayer. There's also opportunity to give offerings. So we have some boxes there in the back if you are wanting to offer to God. And once again, this is an offering of thanksgiving, trusting him with our resources, what God has given us. If we could all stand as we come into this last period of worship. And I would just like to just pray for us, just really quick. Just for God, just to take what we've heard and hopefully let it stir something in your heart. And to know that God is urgently asking us to follow him. And if God is doing that, that we wouldn't ask God to wait anymore. And that we would ask God to reveal to us truly where our home is and not let our home be defined by where we are, but to realize that our home is in heaven. And finally, to put our trust into God. Because I guarantee you, he will not betray that trust. So, Father, I thank you. We love you. And may you be glorified. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail, and you won't stop.
Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. And I trust in God, my Savior, never fail. blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood, and what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, and all is at rest. And I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song, praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I sought the Lord. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust in, that's why I trust in God, my Savior. He will never fail, and I trust in God. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Lord's call to us, that we would trust him when Jesus says, follow me. What an encouraging message, what an encouraging time to be able to place our trust in him. Today is our lunch wagon, which means not only just great tasty food, but more importantly, the opportunity for us as church to come connect, to fellowship, to get to know somebody new. And so I'm going to go ahead and pray for us right before we partake lunch together. Father God, thank you so much for today, the call for us, that when we make that declaration that says, Jesus, you are our Lord and Savior, we will lay down what we have, everything we have, to follow you. It is the greatest act of trust and obedience that we place in you, in truly calling you our Lord and our Savior. But we don't do it on our own. You give us Holy Spirit to be able to walk with us each and every day. And we thank you for today, just the opportunity for us to gather together, the church family, to break bread together, to hear the God stories, to get to meet new people, to be able to see how you are continuing to move here in Cornerstone, to be a light unto the world. Thank you for the food to bless us. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, guys. Have a great week.